Hello, and welcome to an extra spooky version of Listen Toys, the podcast series that we haven't done very much with in the last year. And today, to bring it back, we thought we'd do a bit of a Halloween special. And by that, I mean, I thought we'd do one, and I kind of roped everyone else into it. So I'll explain the concept in a second. It's pretty fucking straightforward, I suppose. It's a Halloween-themed Listen Toys. But joining me today is Dan.
Hello.
Tim.
Hello.
And Tom.
Ooh, yeah.
So today, instead of focusing on an album, as we've done in other Listen Toys episodes, today I have tasked our intrepid spook hunters with just a task of finding one Halloween-themed song. Now, my kind of outline of this is it's the quintessential Halloween song in your mind. So last year, for those of you who watched the Draw Toys Halloween special, might remember we ended our spooky episode by discussing our favourite Halloween movies. And so this year I thought, hey, you know, there's quite a lot of Halloween music out there, as I realised when I was compiling a playlist for myself. So I thought, hey, let's have a chat about that, of arguably my favourite time of the year. I quite like Halloween. But enough about this rambling. It is time to get on with it. So I trust everyone has their selections in front of them?
Yes.
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 Right. Well, in that case, I shall start it off, as is tradition. And I think having it as the start is appropriate as well, because I'd maybe argue that in terms of all of our songs, this is probably the earliest song in chronological order. And also, the start is kind of what sets this song apart, and I think is what will be familiar to most people. So my choice for my Halloween song, the quintessential Halloween kind of themey thing, is Toccata and Fugue in D minor by Johann Sebastian Bach.
I mean, very spooky.
So, we've got different ways with this.
Oh, yeah.
Very different ways.
I'm hoping for a nice spooky bit of variety. So anyway, we're all going to go off and listen to it now. Here's about a 15-second piece of it, because viewers at home are probably wondering, what the hell is that piece of music? What is he on about? Once you hear it, you'll know what I mean. Anyway, be back soon. Right, okay, we are back, and we have just sat through 9 minutes and 21 seconds of Toccata and Fugue in D minor by Johann Sebastian Bach. So I'd just like to say the obvious right from the outset. Yes, I know a lot of people in the comments are probably already going to be saying, are you sure it's Johann Sebastian Bach? And no, I appreciate that actually we don't know for certain if it actually was. But I'm just going to give a very quick rundown to the closest of academic knowledge that was it was written and performed roughly in 1730. We don't actually have the exact date, and we don't actually know it's exactly Bach either, as from what I could tell from the reading I did, it was a copy made by someone collecting the works of the student of Bach. So it's maybe, possibly, and there's a big old scholarly argument about it, but that's not the point of this video, so if you want to know more about that, just read it up. It's quite fascinating. I didn't understand half of it, because I don't know how to read music, but...
But fortunately tonight, Rid actually has audio of the original.
Definitive answer.
Well, fun fact, I do believe that were it not for that one copy made by that one archivist, this piece could have been lost to history, apparently.
That's a crazy thought. Makes you think how much has been lost.
Absolutely, yeah. Well,
just like Toy Story 2.
What?
The same thing happened with Toy Story 2. They lost all the files to Toy Story 2, but there was this one woman who worked in the office that happened to have it all on her computer, so they had to like go to her house and be like, I was reading about it the other day, and they had to like go to her house, and she had it all on like her desktop computer, and they had to like transport her home desktop computer into the office and like protect it to make sure nothing happened to her, because it was like the only source for Toy Story 2.
Wow, holy shit, that's
in a lot of ways, you know, Takata and Fugue and Toy Story 2 share a lot of similarities.
Yes, and talking of similarities, just before we open the floor up to comments and everything as well, so I did a brief bit of Googling to see how well known this was, or how like acknowledged the fact is, but this may have struck out to you, Tim, specifically. That you could, if you've listened to the song Dancing Mad from Final Fantasy VI, you will have noticed there were very, very heavily inspired segments. I'm pretty sure, actually, around the 4 minute piece, there's a solo like high part of the keyboard playing that actually plays during Dancing Mad.
Yeah, parts of the melody are pretty much just ripped straight from it. I'm pretty sure Nobu has talked about it and said, it's very much inspired by it.
I mean, Nobu Uematsu.
Yeah, it was evident.
Yeah, Uematsu is like a massive classic music nerd anyway, so it's incredibly fitting.
We did talk the other day about something like this, about the like Japanese media often using classical music from Europe in a lot of their like movies, like Battle Royale and stuff. So yeah, that just proves the kind of theme with that.
Yeah, it definitely and that's part of the reason I love this piece as well. So I know it does sound rather hipsterish of me to be like, well, my choice of Halloween's a classical composition. But years ago, I found out the name of this song, and I was like, "Oh my god! I finally know what it's called. It's not just spooky music." And I gave it a
spooky organ music.
Well, I gave it a listen, expecting like, "Oh, this will be a nice ambient like 5 minute piece," and I was just blown away that like 2 or 3 minutes into it, it's like, "Wow, this becomes a fully different song. Like it's still ominous and still like foreboding, but it's got so much going on. There's like, wow, this is." Probably my favourite piece of organ music.
Well, I've got a question regarding it, really. The thing with this song, that intro to it, I can almost hear the lightning bolt striking at the same time. Now, what I wanted to ask is...
Why?
When was this first used?
So,
when? Right. What made this popular?
From my reading, again, I was using Wikipedia mostly for this, and I think there was one article I read on a classic music website. I can't remember the name now. But anyway, so this was used in the 20s and 30s for like a few horror pieces, back before there were soundtracks to movies. Obviously, an orchestra or a recording of it would play alongside the movie. And this was used as like, ooh, creepy haunted house thing. But... the thing that cements it, and I haven't seen this, but I'm now aware of it and definitely going to watch it soon. In 1940, a little-known Disney film called Fantasia came out. And this featured near the start, I think. And so that kind of cemented it in the conscience of, like, spooky music. And then I think from Fantasia on, it kind of became the de facto... oh, we need a bit of classical music, but we can only use like 15 seconds. And, you know, the first 15 seconds of that song is the most iconic. Afterwards, you'd probably,
This is in the public domain now, though, isn't it? So I think you can use what you want of this.
Yes, I'm
fairly certain.
Yes and no. So what I was reading as well is the... so the specific one we listened to was obviously a recording by an organist himself. Mm. So I think this particular version is still slightly copyrighted in the fact that it's a performance. Because the middle pieces, especially of Toccata and Fugue, do vary a little. Now, I've listened to one on Spotify that is different to this one, and I noticed one or two little changes, like things were a little faster or a little more sort of complex, as it were. So I think it's all a little bit up to interpretation. But yeah, to be honest, this is the public domain now. Anyone could perform Toccata and Fugue and release it without any issue.
You'd need a pretty hardcore organ to play this.
Oh, yeah.
To its, like a massive cathedral organ. That's all I can think. Nothing yeah. small, you know.
No, I'll get a Fisher Price keyboard.
Ha ha ha! One.
So, anyway, what's your guys' view on it? Hopefully, it wasn't too insufferable to sit through 9 minutes of.
No, definitely not. It's I don't know. There's something strange about Toccata and Fugue, because it's funny that you chose it for the Halloween, because even though it does have that spooky feel to it, I also find it quite relaxing. Mm. It's quite like a there's something quite soothing about it. I don't know if that says more about my mental state than it does about the song itself. But it's one of those things where we listened to 9 minutes of it, but it didn't feel like 9 minutes, because it kind of puts you in a little bit of a trance, I'd say.
Yeah, people theorise it's meant to represent... Well, sorry, some people theorise and other people say that it's absolutely not, but some people reckon it's meant to represent a storm, which kind of makes sense in that it's intense and then it's not, then it's intense again, and, you know.
Well, yeah, with the, like, it kind of breaks it into phases, which I think, again, goes back to why it got inspired by, why Nobuo Matsu got inspired by it to put it as the final boss music, because yeah. it has that kind of phase feel to it, where it's like, here's the first phase of the fight or the storm, where it's like building up, here is like the intense part where you're fighting and shit, and then there's like a kind of calm down at the end, like the storm has passed, you've beaten the boss. So I think that holds some credit.
I've got to acknowledge the skill that this must take to play. The points where it's so quick and there's so many different key presses, it must be a feat. And also, you do wonder, when this was first composed, what he would have thought, like, knowing now it's like in every horror piece of media, you know what I mean?
Yeah. I tried reading up on reception of this, but because the origin itself is so hard to, like, stick, it's really hard to tell what people thought of it. I mean, technically, the fact it was almost lost to time, I suppose, would suggest it wasn't loved, but, you know, it's hard to say. Maybe it was just unfortunate things, but yeah. Dan, what did you think?
I just imagined myself just walking around a graveyard and just cackling.
For no apparent reason.
Yeah, we what were you doing in that graveyard? Can we ask? Is it fit for YouTube?
No. Like, do you sometimes play that game? Just guess how old the dead people are around the gravestones.
Well, not necessarily.
It usually says on the gravestones, yeah, Dan.
Well, sometimes it'd be, you know, you turn around, have a guess, then turn around. Was it 1840? No, it was 1870. No.
Well, in the comment section below, right? I can't say I've played it. However, I think we have a very small sample group here. In the comments below, let me know if you've ever played Guess the Year of the Death of the Graveyard Occupant.
And let us know what other games you play in the graveyard.
Yeah, and remember, there is always help out there. So, you know.
Do you know, I was just thinking, there's always this, and I thought about this the other day as well. This song, the image I had in my head was a lightning bolt, obviously. And it makes sense, though, you say storms.
Yeah, you are right.
But it's the lightning bolt hitting by those, this like that house. Not even a castle. There's like those style of houses, like traditionally what you saw with the Adams family living in.
Yeah, yeah.
And they're like in America. And I think of those houses, like in a slightly off purple. And it's weird how those houses now have come to be associated with horror. You know the type of house I mean. I'm sure Rydian will put a picture up of one of these type of houses.
I'm pretty sure Salem's Lot by Stephen King is set in a house like that. That's sort of one of the archetype ones. Yeah. Right.
But,
well, unless anyone else has anything to add to this modern banger, time to move on. Who would like to go next with their spooky Halloween song?
Go on, I'll go next. Right, so I was worried someone else would pick this, so I'm glad I got in early. Maybe someone has it, but we'll see. So I picked Spooky Scary Skeletons.
What version specifically, and by who? Just so I can...
Oh, the original by Andrew Gowalt, released in 1996.
All right, well, let's have a listen to Spooky Scary Skeletons, and we'll be right back very shortly.
Spooky Scary Skeletons and shivers down your spine. Shrieking skulls will shock your soul, seal your doom tonight. Spooky Scary Skeletons speak with such a screech. You'll shake and shudder in surprise when you hear these zombies shriek.
All right, we are back and we've just listened to a little bit of the original Spooky Scary Skeletons song. So Tom, why don't you tell us a little bit about that track?
So Spooky Scary Skeletons is recently become a bit of a hit. It was actually released in 96. Believe it or not, it was released in August, which I kind of chuckled over. It was created by a guy called Andrew Gold. And the album itself was a Halloween album specifically made for kids. Some interesting things about it. The album was called Halloween Howls. And it also had covers on it of Monster Mash, Ghostbusters, and the Addams Family. Ooh. Some other kind of classic Halloween tunes for the period. So the reason I showed you that video, guys, as opposed to like just a straight version of the song.
It'll be linked in the description as well. Just so every song, sorry, I forgot to mention this at the top. Every song we listen to, I'll link to the YouTube video that we used, and if it's on Spotify, that one too.
So that, the footage you saw was a Disney short film called Skeleton Dance. And that was the re-upload of that song to YouTube, and from what I understand, it was the first use of that song on YouTube. And that video now, as we speak, has 24 million viewers.
Ooh.
So obviously the video, you see them playing the xylophone and stuff on the skeleton, and it kind of makes sense why that was picked. But oh, I forgot to know it down, but that video was from, there you go. It was from 1929, that Disney short. So it's a very old Disney short, that one. Probably would have been shown like almost exclusively in movie theatres at the time. So from what I understand, it spread. It really became popular when the 4chan board V decided to all sing it. So what 4chan often does, they'll do like a group sing of like a famous song. So they all decided they to.
Sonic song, they did fucking
They
escaped, didn't they?
So a bunch of people would record their voices singing the song, and it'd all be put together. And that was done in 2012. But since then, it's become a bit of a phenomena, and
I think
it's
I know
a bit
why.
Of a joke song, if anything.
Well,
a lot of people have covered it.
Yeah, I always thought it got big because of the Living Tombstone remix. I always thought that's why it kind of kicked off. But apparently it kicked off before that, and that's just
well, I wouldn't incidental. Be surprised if they kind of fed into each other. Maybe the Living Tombstone was because he's a big, he does lots of songs about meme-y kind of stuff, so wouldn't be surprised if he'd maybe heard that, seen the meme popularity, and was like, "Ah, this is gonna be a good idea," and remixed it.
I looked at the Know Your Meme page, and I, funnily enough, that was up there. The Nianas cover was up there.
Of course.
Oh, best
one of our favourite people on the internet. But I'm interested, guys. What was your first exposure to this song? I remember my first time seeing it was... There's a video, and it's also put to the GTA San Andreas song of a man with a pumpkin head in
black
body suit,
yeah,
dancing in a graveyard.
Yeah,
so that's been put to every Halloween song ever. It's been put to Pumpkin Hill as well. I love that guy.
And that was my first exposure. But I've got to say, my favourite is that GTA San Andreas version of that, because yeah, it's hilarious. But I'm interested, what were your guys' first exposure?
I'm pretty sure mine was the Living Tombstone remix. I think I just stumbled across it on YouTube and thought, this is a banger. So I think I heard that before I heard the original. And then I was like, oh, right, okay, so it comes from this. And then I never questioned it further. It's funny that I've listened to it so many times, but I've never looked into where it came from. So you explaining all that just now is just the first I've heard of it.
I was the same as Tim. I think I was aware of the Living Tombstone around the time that got big. Obviously, I think he released it near Halloween, because I remember playing it quite a lot. I think, yeah, it was probably around 2012 or so. I always assumed it was from something, and I presumed it was either a film or a kid's album, because I know they do lots of Christmassy ones and stuff like that. So it makes a lot of sense. To be honest, though, listening to the original was a bit strange, because I've only heard the original two or three times, and I was like, have they slowed this down? Have they pitch shifted it or something? But yeah, obviously the remix pitch shifts it up and makes it faster.
Yeah.
So it's it's that strange feeling of it sounds a bit more sinister, to be honest. I mean, obviously it's a very silly song. Also, just a PSA, I'd like to say, on this channel, we do not support anti-skeleton propaganda, and...
When they're peaceful.
Yes. Now, so a majority of skeletons are peaceful. We know that for a fact. So please do not judge all skeletons as spooky and scary, as many of them are very friendly.
They just want to socialise.
Yeah.
Do you know... another thing that I found funny is the whole association of xylophones with skeletons. It goes way back beyond this song, I think, but it's just, I guess, playing music on the bones, but I just find it funny, whenever you hear skeletons in children's films and stuff, you always hear the xylophone starting to go.
Yeah, that's true. I wonder if old xylophones were made from bone or something.
I will say, recently in news, there was a guy from Florida who made a skeleton guitar out of his uncle's remains.
Wow. Well.
Oh my God. Florida man, yet again.
Florida man, of course. Of course.
Wow. Well, there we are. Well, if you can make a guitar, I mean... Xylophones are the logical next step.
It's such a funny story, because he's well, what it was, his uncle donated his body to science, right? And then a couple of years later, they're like, right, well, we're given the body back. And this can be a problem for some families, because then they have to arrange a funeral for a death that happened 7 years ago or something like that. So he doesn't know what to do, and then he's like, I know what I'll do, it'll be a fitting
shred.
Yeah, I mean, he was a metalhead as well, his uncle, so he was like, oh, it's what he would have wanted.
Yeah, I mean, to be fair, I think that is... I mean, it's macabre, certainly, but I don't know, I think that's quite kind of cool as well, I'd say.
I can think of a even more macabre one, but it's not entirely true.
Oh.
Have you guys heard of the Sally Acorn dolls?
Oh, God. Oh, Jesus Christ.
Oh, good grief.
Yeah.
We're on a tangent here.
Okay, all I'm going to say to cut this short and to not get me banned, if you're interested in this, type in Sally Acorn skeleton doll. There we are. That'll lead you down a... It's coming up to Halloween. Hopefully you're in the spooky mood because... prepare yourself. Oh, right. On that delightful note, if no one else has anything else to add, we'll move on to the next spooky pick. Who would like to put theirs next?
Well, I'll jump in next. So I've gone in a completely different direction to the two of you. I'd say mine isn't as directly Halloween inspired, but it's definitely spooky. And it definitely has Halloween-y themes. So the song I've gone for is Goodnight Moon by the band Shivery. And I want to play a little game because I don't know if any of you will recognize the song, but it is played in the credits of quite a popular movie. So once we listen to it, I want to see if you can tell me what movie that might be.
All right, well, listen out for that. We're going to go listen to Goodnight Moon by Shivery, and we'll be back pretty soon. All right, we are back, and we have just listened to Goodnight Moon by Shiver. Right, Tim, take it away and introduce what that song was.
So, that song was by the band Shivery, which is an American band who didn't do much aside from this. They were kind of a one-hit wonder. It was released back in 1999 on the 1st of January. They released it on New Year's Day.
Ah.
And it's from the album, and this is one of my favourite album names of all time. It's from the album, I Ought to Give You a Shot in the Head for Making Me Live in This Dump.
Nice.
Which, absolutely fantastic name for an album. The band disbanded in 2007. They didn't. This got to number one in some random EU countries. Like, it got to number one in, like, Italy for some reason. The reason most people know it is because of what film it's featured in. Does anyone know what film's credits it's
going to be? I'm going to guess Shaun of the Dead, but I know I'm wrong.
You are wrong. Anyone else?
That's what I was thinking as well. But
also, Shaun of the Dead came out in 2004.
Yeah, but I mean, if it came out in 99, I mean,
this song, this film did not come out.
I thought you said 2007, Tim. Sorry. Oh.
No, the band broke up in 2007. The song came out in 1999.
Sorry, mate. Yeah.
Attention span is gone. So this film featured in the credit sequence of Kill Bill Volume 2. Which is kind of what got it.
Right.
Yeah, it kind of makes sense. There's something about the like country-ish feel to it. Do you know what I mean?
Delta blues kind of stuff. I honestly I don't think I've ever heard that before. If I did, I've forgotten the reviewed it, but I really dug that. Thank you for introducing me to it. I'll definitely check out that band because they seem quite interesting. Like, I like the sound. It's very cool.
Because obviously I went for one that isn't as directly Halloween-ish, but it has such a spooky feel to it. Mm. And I think part of what makes it so spooky, aside from, you know, the kind of, like, softened vocals and the kind of weird sounds, is the bit where it keeps going, dun, 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 and it kind of like goes down. And I think there's something kind of weirdly inherently spooky about doing that in songs that gives it like a Halloween feeling.
And
I couldn't tell you what, to be honest.
In the background, there was a bit of theremin as well.
Which
I'm a
is
big sucker for theremin. So that's
absolutely
Halloween staple.
Very spooky.
For me, I just like the guitar tone. I think it's quite almost forlorn in a way, but I liked it. Hmm. I really enjoyed it.
Honestly, I could picture it featuring in like The Hills Have Eyes or something. It like gave me that kind of vibe of like out in the desert, but
yeah,
it's foreboding and like it's not happy, you know.
Like like a neo kind of western style. Those sort of films are. Yeah, I felt that as well. I could almost feel going into like a, I don't know, like a haunted saloon or something.
Well, thank you, Tim. That was fully unexpected. I did not picture anything like that coming out tonight. So, wow.
There you go.
Unless anyone else has anything else to add, we'll go to our final resting place for the night.
Talking about things that you won't expect coming. Here we go.
I'm excited for this. Daniel, would you like to wrap up this episode with your music choice on the theme of Halloween?
Yes, I will. So the song I've chosen is Bela Lugosi's Dead by Bauhaus.
Yes.
Right. Basically, that came out, right, in 1979. But that song, right, basically invented the goth genre there and then.
We'll get into that after we give it a listen. So, right, sit back and take in the enormity of Bela Lugosi's Dead by Bauhaus. See you guys in a minute. Bela Lugosi's dead, the bats have bled, the bell tower, the victims have been bled, and velvet lines, the black box. Bela Lugosi's dead. Bela Lugosi's dead. All right, we are back. We've just listened to the Bauhaus classic Bela Lugosi's Dead. So, Dan, would you like to tell us a little bit more about that track?
Yeah, so, yeah, basically, that came out in 1979. And to me, right, while it's not like spooky, scary skeletons or Toccata and Fugue, to me, I think this is like the most important, it's an important record because it's the song that started the goth genre. And basically, while it is, yes, it's 9 minutes and 37 long, it's a great song. I wouldn't play it at a bar, by all means. I think that would scare people off.
Challenge accepted.
I don't know, a goth bar, I imagine like a really hard goth bar.
I think if they really, really respect, like, yeah, yeah, it would work, but I think any other bar, I think you would get some dodgy looks. But to me, it's one of my favourite songs made because I generally feel uneasy when I listen to it, but I also at the same time I really enjoy it, and that's what to me is what, you know, horror is. You know, it's you know, it scares you, but it draws you in as well. But yeah, without this song, you wouldn't have bands like The Cure, Misfits, Typo Negative, Nine Inch Nails, My Chemical Romance, or even Moby. Apparently Moby was inspired by this song. So, I mean, there's a list of bands that have been inspired by this. And for those not in the know, you might be wondering, well, who is actually Bela Lugosi? And, of course, he was a Hungarian American actor that played Dracula in the 1930s, and
he was the first Dracula on screen. He was the Dracula for a particular generation, along with Boris Karloff as Frankenstein and a few others.
I mean, yeah, along with him and Bela Lugosi, they're just cemented in.
Yeah, I mean, Bela Lugosi, this is not the best analogy. Bela Lugosi is like the Robert Downey Jr. of his day. Like, if you know, he was that archetype. Like, you didn't think he'd be playing the kind of, like, you know, the macho man or ever, but you knew he was the creepy dude. He was the, like, you know.
Yeah, he was typecasted into, like, creepy, scary roles because that was what he was good at. And I guess, like, with his, you know, he's from Hungary, so his accent was quite limited, so I mean, he fits the role perfectly into Dracula because
it's what everyone thinks of when you think of "I want to suck your blood." It's Bela Lugosi. Like, if they just got a regular American accent, an actor to play it, like, yeah, I don't know, like Dracula would have been completely different. So,
well, I mean. I think of Christopher Lee, actually.
Well, yeah, so every generation has a Dracula.
Yeah, yeah.
I thought you were going to say Adam Sandler.
Yes. There is a generation. There is a generation that will grow up where Adam Sandler is Dracula for them. So
I want to go back to the actual lyrics, and you know, having it got in front of me here, I think the writing is just it's almost like poetry. Like, I love it. Like, the virginal brides file past his tomb, strewn with time's dead flowers, bereft in deathly bloom, alone in a darkened room. The count. I just think it's written
well,
really well.
As you say, it's like the start of goth music. It's very goth poetry, sort of, like, you know.
And what I like about the music, it's quite, you know, I think the bass line is what I think draws people in, and then you got like the I'm pretty sure it's like the reverb of the guitars as well, and it's like,
well, and you've got the drums. But it's recorded at a distance. There's an echo to it. It's like...
Oh, yeah, yeah. Like, so, a delay factor going in as well,
so
you know.
You've got the footstep kind of like in an empty hall kind of effect as well.
So it feels really disorientating when you listen to it. And I guess that what makes the listener feel quite uncomfortable in a sense, you know.
I sense like almost like a grandfather clock ticking. And then being wound backwards, from the all like a creaking floor, even.
But yeah.
That's where I got from that, which you know, all creaky noises
throughout. Yeah, throughout it, I got the sense that like something was coming towards me very slowly, and I think that's part of what made it feel so like disorienting, because it was like, oh, something's literally creeping towards me, and that's all I got. Spooky.
To borrow your analogy, Dan, you mentioned Toccata and Fugue made you feel like you were walking through a graveyard. Well, in my like mind tapestry, if I was to put the two songs together, Toccata and Fugue to me is visiting a weird abandoned church, and Bela Lugosi's Dead is walking through the graveyard as you like leave the church in a hurry, sort of. It's foreboding. It's a brilliant piece of music.
Yeah, it's before you start playing the Guess the Age on the Tombstone.
Of course, yeah. I mean that's the slow creeping. It's not, nothing's after you. It's Dan slowly going through a graveyard because he's trying to guess the age of every tombstone. He's not following you. He's just not out the graveyard yet. He's going to be half an hour. It's fine. You can leave when you want.
He, Bela Lugosi died in 1956. There you go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Fun fact.
But I guess, like, he was very much, like, again, he was in a lot of horror films, and, you know, he was very much in the conscience of the cinema, so I think, but it was also kind of like, you know, even the song itself, you know, it's not, you know, you say Bela Lugosi's dead, you're not actually thinking of, because in your mind you're thinking Dracula, but they're actually saying, no, the actor is dead. And they imagine him, like, all the brides, you know, like, as if he is this, you know, as if his character's real. So it's quite, even then it's disorientating in that. But, there we go.
It's clear that the members of Bauhaus, or at least, like, whoever wrote this song, clearly, like, grew up with, you know, Bela Lugosi films, or, like, that version of Dracula, because sort of, that there is a sort of, you know, as you say, the song is about Bela Lugosi, as in the, like, he's dead. We're going to make a monument to this. And also make a very influential goth song, so.
Yeah, I can tell you now, I just checked the wiki, there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 covers. Of wow. Bela Lugosi.
12 covers.
Well, and on that note, I think it's time to end this episode as we all slowly slink back into our graves until life demands that we rise again to record another podcast.
For the next Listen Toys.
And,
has everyone listened to my one from the last episode?
So I was gonna get onto that. So I think it's completely my fault. I've kind of let it lapse a little bit. I've just been fairly busy.
I'll be honest. Like there was like at the time I was like, "Ooh, there's a record that's gonna come out soon. I'm gonna save it for the podcast."
We had some plans and they never came to fruition. But hopefully. You know, I'm gonna try and do this again. This is kind of getting back into Listen Toys, and obviously there's other podcasts as well. This is a good segue into advertising at the end, actually. So I'll leave a playlist to Listen Toys. We've also got a drawing podcast called Draw Toys, where we draw things in a limited amount of time. And we've also got the more general Talk Toys, where we chat about things. So look forward to those, because I've got a few ideas coming up, so they will be going on in the future, and they'll be featuring these three lovely gentlemen, assuming they're all still up for featuring in it. And yeah, I hope you all have a spooky Halloween, and I hope you're watching this before Halloween or during Halloween and not like mid-November, because that's just going to feel weird then, isn't it? Yeah, well, thank you guys very much for joining me today. I think it's been fun. I think we've all had... Honestly, I'm really happy, right? All of the songs have not been ones I predicted. Like...
No.
Oh, well, maybe at a push, Spooky Scary Skeletons, but I wasn't really expecting it. There was more kind of...
And they weren't similar to each other in any way whatsoever.
Yeah, no, you could listen to all four of these in a small playlist and be like, wow, there's a... That was a palette of, you know, different types of music. But yeah, well, thank you guys. You've introduced me to some new music, and hopefully the listeners too. If you enjoyed this, let me know in the comments below. And also, let me know what your Halloween track is. Because, I mean, if we get enough comments, we could even do a part two where we listen to these tracks. We're not going to get any comments, but if we do, in the off chance, that would be nice. You don't have to, though, but I appreciate you for listening to this. It means a lot to me. I've probably spent at least an hour editing this, so, you know.
Red is like his psyche is crying, please, please, please.
Well, anyway, I'm going to wrap it up now and then go sob in a darkened room with a singular candle burning whilst Bela Lugosi's Dead plays on a loop. Right, well, until next time, and God knows when that's going to be, goodbye.